We want to find the open intervals for which the function is increasing and decreasing, then state any local or relative extrema. So looking at the given function though, notice how the domain would not include 0. So let's make a note of this on the side. The domain of the given function would be all reals except 0. So we'd have the interval from negative infinity to 0 and from 0 to infinity, again not including 0. Next, we'll find the critical numbers, which are where the first derivative is equal to 0 or undefined. Before we find the first derivative though, let's rewrite this second term. 3 divided by x, if we move this up to the numerator, would be equivalent to 3x raised to the power of negative 1. So let's write the given function as 4x plus 3x to the negative 1, and now we'll find the first derivative, which is equal to the derivative of 4x, which is 4. The derivative of 3x to the negative 1, we'd multiply by negative 1, so we'd have minus 3x to the power of negative 1 minus 1, that's negative 2. And let's write this as 4 minus 3 divided by x squared. Notice how the first derivative is undefined at x equals 0, but we already know 0 is not in the domain of the function. So 0 is not a critical number, but it will affect the intervals that we set up to test the sign of the first derivative. So now let's determine whether the first derivative would be 0. So let's go ahead and add this fraction to both sides, which would give us 4 equals 3 divided by x squared. And now from here, we could write 4 as 4 over 1 and cross multiply and solve for x, or we can just multiply both sides by x squared to clear the fraction. So now we have 4x squared is equal to 3, dividing both sides by 4. We have x squared equals 3/4, and now we would take the square root of both sides of the equation. Remember, we'll have two solutions here, so we have plus or minus here. So we have x equals, the square root of 4 in the denominator would be 2. The numerator is going to be the square root of 3, which doesn't simplify, so we have x equals plus or minus the square root of 3 divided by 2. So we actually have two critical numbers, which are x equals negative square root of 3 divided by 2, and x equals positive square root of 3 divided by 2. Let's also get the decimal approximations for these two. You may recognize these values from trigonometry. This is approximately negative 0.8660, and this is approximately positive 0.8660. So now we use these critical numbers. So now we use these two critical numbers and divide the domain of the given function into intervals and test the sign of the first derivative in each of those intervals. If the first derivative is positive, the function is increasing over the interval. And if the first derivative is negative, the function is decreasing over the interval. So again, because 0 is not in the domain of our function, we'll divide the number line into four intervals using these two critical numbers and x equals 0. And to save some time, I've already set this up. The first interval is from negative infinity to negative square root 3 divided by 2. I've also included the decimal approximations, which will be helpful in the next step. The next interval is from negative square root 3 divided by 2 to 0, then from 0 to square root 3 divided by 2, and then finally from square root 3 divided by 2 to infinity. And now we'll select a test value in each interval, and this is why it's often helpful to have the decimal approximations. So for this first interval, let's use x equals negative 1. For this interval here, let's use x equals negative 0.5. Let's use x equals positive 0.5 here, and we use x equals 1 here. Now we'll substitute these x values into our first derivative to determine the sign of the first derivative, which will then tell us whether the function is increasing or decreasing over that interval. And we'll go ahead and do this using the graphing calculator. There are several ways to do this on the calculator. Let's begin by entering the original function in y1 and the derivative function in y2. So I'm going to press y equals, and notice I've already entered the original function in y1 and the derivative function in y2. And now to evaluate the first derivative at our test values, we could use the y variables from the home screen, but in this video I want to show how to use the table feature. So before we grow the table, let's press second window for table set, and make sure the independent variable is set on ask. Once it is, we can press second graph of the table, and then we simply enter our test values, which I've already done by just entering negative 1, enter, negative 0.5, enter, and so on. Just remember that the first derivative is in y2, the divisional function is in y1. So notice how at x equals negative 1, the first derivative is positive, but for the next two test values, negative 0.5 and positive 0.5, the first derivative is negative, and at x equals 1, the first derivative is positive. So the first derivative is positive over this interval, negative over this interval, negative over this interval, and positive over this interval. So now we know the function is increasing over this interval because the first derivative is positive. The function is decreasing over this interval because the first derivative is negative. The function is also decreasing over this interval and increasing over this interval. Now that we know the intervals to which the function is increasing or decreasing, we can now determine any local or relative extrema. Over this interval, the function is increasing, but then over this interval, the function is decreasing. So because the function changes from increasing to decreasing, at x equals negative square root 3 divided by 2, we'd have a high point or relative or local maximum. And notice how it changes from decreasing to increasing at x equals positive square root 3 divided by 2, which means the function would have a low point or relative or local minimum at x equals positive square root 3 divided by 2. To determine the local or relative maximum min values though, we do have to evaluate the original function at x equals negative square root 3 divided by 2 and positive square root 3 divided by 2. But looking at the two sentences below, this function has a local maximum at x equals negative square root 3 divided by 2 with the value of, again, to find the value of the local maximum, we need to evaluate the original function at f of negative square root 3 divided by 2, which we'll do in just a moment. Let's take a look at the second sentence though. This function has a local minimum, or a low point, at x equals positive square root 3 divided by 2, with a value of, again, to find the local minimum value, we need to evaluate the original function f at positive square root 3 divided by 2. So now let's go to the calculator and determine these function values. And again, there's a couple ways of doing this. We could use the y variables and evaluate y2 at these input values. But since we already have the table open, let's go ahead and use the table feature. So let's go down to this fifth row and we'll enter negative square root 3 divided by 2 for x. So negative and then square root 3, close parenthesis, divided by 2, enter. And let's also enter positive square root 3 divided by 2. So second x squared for the square root, 3, close parenthesis, divided by 2, and enter. Now remember we had a local maximum at negative square root 3 divided by 2. So if we go up to this row and over to, again, y1, the function value, to 4 decimal places, the relative or local maximum would be approximately negative 6.9282. If we go down to the next row, we know that the relative or local maximum value is approximately positive 6.9282. So again, the relative maximum value is approximately negative 6.9282. And the local minimum value is approximately positive 6.9282. Now let's also verify this graphically. Notice how the function is increasing over this interval, as well as over this interval, which is from negative infinity to negative square root 3 divided by 2, and square root 3 divided by 2 to infinity. Notice the function is decreasing over this interval, as well as over this interval. Which does verify we have a relative maximum here at negative square root 3 divided by 2, and the relative maximum function value is approximately negative 6.9282, and we have a relative minimum function value here at positive square root 3 divided by 2, and that relative or local maximum function value is approximately 6.9282. I hope you found this helpful.